In Latin America, that counts the vast majority of Catholics in the world, Catholicism is historically linked to both the right and left traditions. The church played an important role during dictatorships, supporting an anti-communist speech and reinforcing the values of the traditional family. But it also nourished the birth of social movements when the liberation theology, a movement born inside the church, started to question Latin America's marginalized position in the world and encouraged political, economical, and social liberation of the local population during the 60s, a period when dictatorships reached their peaks. More recently in Brazil, a country where 65% of the population identifies as Catholic, the Vatican was losing ground to a boom of neo-Pentecostal churches, thriving mainly from lower middle class to low economic classes. The church needs to design a strategy to maintain believers, especially among youngsters and poorest. Using very simple yet thoughtful strategies to gain popularity, Pope Francis seduced the population, the political class, and public opinion during his first international visit to Brazil last week. Once in the South American country, he took part of the World Youth Day, celebrated from Monday, July 22nd to Sunday, July 28th. Since the early days of his papacy, the pontiff tried to assume an attitude of proximity and sensibility towards the less advantaged people. While in Brazil, the Pope used an unshielded car, got stuck in traffic jam, helped children, visited favelas, and even accepted tea from a passerby. This attitude is meant to symbolize the beginning of a renovation of the Catholic Church. Followers of the theology of liberation advocate a more significant political role for the Church, and this movement, in the past, has been accused by the Vatican of supporting class struggle and violent revolutions. On a written letter to address our questions, Fray Beto, Dominican friar and a liberation theology prominent figure, declares his support for Pope Francis's austere gestures.
Pope Francisco started the church reform with the reform of his own papacy. No mantle, no red shoes, no cross, no golden ring, no shielded vehicle, no pontiff's palace. He's diverting the church from his monastic vest and gestures. He shows a strong sensibility with poverty. I am convinced that the Catholic Church is entering a new era, one where it will be a worldwide voice for the voiceless people.
While the Pope visited Brazil, the voices on the streets were still struggling to be heard. The population identified that the Pope's visit could uplift the protests and renew the debate about subjects like the lack of ethics of the political class.
Eu acho que esse protesto vai ter maior visibilidade sim, porque não é só o Rio agora olhando e o resto do Brasil. Mas o resto do mundo está vendo isso do Papa. A gente não quer xingar o Papa, a gente não é contra a igreja. Alguns podem até ser, mas é muito pouca gente. A gente só quer que tenha noção do que acontece no Brasil. Uma roubalheira que não tem como explicar.
In another act of support, during his public speeches, Pope Francis has shown solidarity to the population claims and protests, referring to the lack of trust in the public administration and emphasizing the need to establish a dialogue with the population. While addressing the youth on Friday, July 26th, the pontiff declared,
"En la cruz, Jesús está junto a tantos jóvenes que han perdido su confianza en las instituciones políticas porque ven el egoísmo y la corrupción."
And while giving a speech to politicians on Saturday, July 27th, the Pope gave to the political class the following advice.
Además del humanismo integral que respete la cultura original y la responsabilidad solidaria, considero fundamental para afrontar el presente el diálogo constructivo. Entre la indiferencia egoísta y la protesta violenta, siempre hay una opción posible, el diálogo.
However, the consistency of the pontiff's modest attitudes, his public speeches, and the reality of the Catholic Church could be questioned. The Vatican, the institution represented by the Pope, is still one of the world's richest and more powerful institutions, and many think it could do much to implement real improvements regarding life conditions of the poorest. Fray Beto believes that the church should fight poverty, but fighting against the real causes of poverty that he sees as the structures of capitalism.
From the patrimonial point of view, the church is indeed a very rich institution. Cathedrals like St. Patrick in New York, Ze in Sao Paulo, Notre Dame in Paris belong to the church. Even if the church will sell St. Peter's Basilica and the Sistine Chapel and give this money to the poor, that still wouldn't solve the question of poverty. That would only relieve, briefly, the suffering for some of the poor. What the church should do is to fight the causes of poverty. The capitalist system that, as the Pope mentioned in his first interview, trembles in fear when the stock market falls by 4 or 5 points. But it is indifferent when the number of undernourished surpass the 1 or 2 billion people.
However, the strategy behind these speeches could be the one needed by the Church to maintain its hegemony in Latin America. It is unquestionable that Latin America plays a protagonist role in the 21st century's world order, when the region grows to a more prominent place in the international economic panorama, with Brazil as the 6th world's large economy in 2013, surpassing countries like Italy, UK and Russia. Therefore, a Latin American Pope appearing sensible to social issues could be the Church's strategy to mediate and negotiate its own interests in the new dynamics of the contemporary Latin America, a region of the world where we can find the largest number and percentage of Catholics.
Esse Papa, ele traz uma expressão bastante interessante, onde que ele precisa mediar, né, uma série de eixos temáticos, com a temática de gênero, habitação, trabalho, né? E esperanças utópicas de uma suposta revolução que possa ser apresentada na pauta da América Latina, no sentido que a América Latina, principalmente a partir dos anos 80, ela precisa contar uma história de si mesma. O que significa contar uma história de si mesma, né? Ela se coloca enquanto protagonista na grande arena ocidental. Então, o Papa não se direciona à América Latina somente por questões ligadas a afetos, né? Pelo fato dele ser também latino-americano, não. Ele se direciona à América Latina com um discurso político, né? Voltado à questão do ordenamento do rebanho, né? De lidar com novas configurações sociais.
In an international panorama, where adaptation may mean survival in order to maintain the role of the Church, a role that certainly goes beyond spirituality, the Pope needs to address contemporary issues both in the political and the economical arena. Despite his apparently austere posture, it's still unknown how much will Pope Francis do to reform the Church. A start could be to exit the comfort zone of the diplomatic answers to objections towards the Church's dogmas. Another way would be to support the people's struggles for better health, public transit and education, gender struggle, that is, class demands, a posture that would imply not only charity from the richest, but to encourage the population in the fight for the recognition of their rights as a citizen. That is, support the demands of the mass protests held during the Pope's visit to Brazil. Instead, the Pope echoed the slogans of the right, something that could help right-wing parties in the next elections. Reporting from Rio de Janeiro for The Rio News, this is Nerita Oeiras.